Good morning, everybody. Happy second Sunday of Advent. If you didn't know it, Christmas is coming. We're excited that today we are going to be talking about a couple of things that are coming up tonight. We have a cantata, and it's really awesome. It starts at 7 o'clock, and I will tell you, if you did not get a chance to listen to the rehearsal yesterday, you definitely need to come and be a part tonight. It's at 7. There is a reception that follows, and it is a treat. I will tell you, it's a really, really good cantata. We also have a couple of missions that if you're interested in helping, we have the homeless mission that we're doing. They're asking for us to give money to that, fill a sock with money for the homeless children, and or bring socks, gloves, hats, thermal wear, etc., or blankets. So if you are somebody who would like to give to the homeless, it says they need to be returned by January 8th, so please do that. Also, you'll notice that we have one of these up here. If we're out, I'll make sure I give you mine. This has all the things that we're going to be doing over the next weeks and all the highlighted events and all the concerts that we have. Next week, we have the children. They are going to do a play called It's a Wonderful, F-U-L-L, Christmas Life. And so we invite you to come and be a part of that. That's also at 7. And if you could stay, a few of you who can agile and move things, we're going to need to set the stage and everything next week after this service. Also, this week, we do need a couple of people to move this. I can't do that. So, guys, hang around, okay? We need you to move this and a couple of chairs off for tonight's show. We also have, in addition to that, angel tree. There's a whole lot of these little paper things out there on the tray. Those we have adopted 25 families this year, and so there's still a lot more out there. Some of them are as easy as a $25 gift card. If you do not have time to go shopping, or you are not a Amazon or somebody who's good to order things online, money is good. Money's always good. So just make sure that you put on your check, Angel Tree on the bottom in the memo, and we'll make sure we do the shopping for you. Also, we have the Bell Choir coming up on December 8th. And we need somebody to light the Advent candle at the 11 p.m. service. Who here comes to the 11 p.m. service? If you are somebody who comes to the 11 p.m. service and you don't snore, we would love for somebody to sign up to do that. So we have that one out there. That's the only one we've got left to fill. Praise God, the ladies' Bible class and this beautiful family right here will be with us next week. So we're looking forward to that. Those are all the announcements that I have. Are there any more from the body of Christ? Being no more, let us center ourselves and focus on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Thank you. vendors to come forward and as we share together the lighting of the Advent wreath. We'll be singing Emmanuel, Emmanuel. From the mouth of the Most High, reach from end to end and order things mighty and small. Come prepare our hearts that we might walk in your ways.
So you might be glorified today.
Reminding us that God's love is always with us.
That is right. God of wonder and majesty, come and show us your love today. Write your story on our hearts as you come as Emmanuel God with us. In Jesus, our Emmanuel, we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing for the singing of our first hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Thank you.
Transformation. We believe in God, the creator of all things, the giver of life and breath. We believe in Jesus Christ, born Emmanuel, God with us, baptized and revealed, the most beloved Son of God. He sought to heal humanity by taking our brokenness upon himself, suffering for us, dying for us, and being raised from the dead for our sake and for the sake of all the world. We believe that he will come again. We believe in the Holy Spirit continually poured out, refreshing our lives, leading us into a new day, ever birthing the church, the body of Christ in the world. This Spirit is our sole companion and counselor of truth, reminding us of the gift of faith, that ever presence of God, and the promise of eternal life. Thanks be to God. Be seated, and I invite the boys to come forward. All right, last week we talked about all of the decorations. This week I want to talk a little bit about specific decorations. Over here we have what we call a chrismum tree. Do you have any idea what a chrismum tree is? Okay, it's a tree that only has ornaments on it that represent Jesus Christ or something to do with his story. So if you were to look at that tree and there was one ornament that you liked, which one would be your favorite? The camel. Why is the camel in the Christmas story? The three wise men rode on the camel. That's right, and they came from the east. What would be your favorite? The dove. What does a dove represent? Got any ideas? The peace that the Prince of Peace brings. That's right. Also represents the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit came upon Mary, and Mary was found to be with child. And something happened before that, and the angel came to Mary, and the angel told her that she was going to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And all of a sudden, she's pregnant with the Holy Spirit's baby, or God's baby. And Joseph comes, and he says, I don't want nothing to do with that, right? But what does God do then? Can you remember? He sends another angel. That's why I like the angels. The angels are prolific in the Christmas story. They come to Elizabeth. They come to Mary. They come to Joseph. And then they continue to share the message of what we're supposed to do. You know, so often we don't know what to do. And we don't know what to do because we have not prayed about it. And we get in this quandary, and we're trying to figure things out. Well, one of the things that angels do is they are God's messengers, and they tell us what God wants us to do, just like he did to Mary, like he did to Elizabeth, like he did to Joseph. What are other ways that maybe God speaks to us when we don't know what to do? Got any ideas? Think God speaks through your mom? Yeah, you can ask somebody who's older and wiser. How about prayer? How about the Bible? How about the still small voice? How about angels? How about dreams? God talks to us about a lot of ways, doesn't he? So when we don't know what to do, when we don't understand a part of the story like Joseph didn't, what we need to do is we need to pray and ask God for the answers, right? So that's what we're going to find out today, how Joseph not only asked God for the answers, but he was able to live out his life as a godly man because he listened to what God said. Isn't that cool? So let's pray. Are you ready? Dear God, thank you so much for answering our prayers. You know, there's times, Lord, we don't understand. But we know you know the whole story. So guide us, abide in us, and teach us where we must go. Not only be the star, but be the angel that directs, the still small voice that guides, the word of God that speaks. Give us all we need so we might know what ways to go. In Jesus' name, amen.
Land of perfect day, beautiful star of
These are called the Trinity Boys. At least that's what they're calling themselves today. If you've got another name, they're taking bids. That's what they call themselves, the Trinity Boys. Our scripture today is one that is familiar to you. Hopefully we can put a new understanding on it. We've been talking about God's story through us. And so what we're going to be doing is looking at God's story through Joseph and how Joseph's life was a vessel for God to tell his story through. Let's read the scriptures together. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant with the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, I ask that as we look at Joseph once again, this righteous, loving man, that you would open our hearts by the power of your Spirit, that you would help us to understand what it is that you need us to grasp today, so that his story and your story and our story would intersect in ways that call us to be faithful. Faithful like Jesus. Faithful like Joseph. Faithful that we might be a part of your story in the greater story of the world. I pray this all through Jesus' name, and all of the people say amen. It was about 19 years ago that my daughter and son-in-law called Mike and I and said, "We need to have a meeting." Now, Aubrey at this time had been through college and was in her second year and about ready to complete that. Jared had just graduated, and we thought, they're going to get engaged. We were excited. They had been dating for 5 years, and all of a sudden, as we're on the front porch, they blurted out, "We're pregnant." Not what we expected. My expectations for my daughter and future son-in-law was they would go through college. They would get their degrees. They would get a good job. They would buy a house, get the dog, the cat, and then have the babies. How could God be in a story like that? When your children don't turn out to be the way you expect them to be? How can God be in the midst of a story that just seems wrong to you? And yet God was so in that story, because now 18 years later, Jared has almost completed 20 years of the Marine Corps. They are one of the solidest Christian families. And I have 5 beautiful grandchildren. How can God be in a story like that just doesn't seem to make sense? That's what we see with Joseph. I mean, there he is. He finds out that Mary is pregnant. And who knows who the father is? I mean, I'm not so sure that God can be in such a thing like that, can he? What do you do when you get into situations like that? What do you decide what to do? I know that Aubrey and Jared said, we prayed about it and we're going to keep the baby. The next thing they said is, we know we need to be responsible and care for this child. Jared's going to join the Marine Corps. Once I get through this year of school, we're going to get married and we're going to raise this family. What do you do when life doesn't turn out the way you think it should? When your kids mess up and they don't live according to your plan? Isn't that interesting? I said, your plan, my plan. Where is God in the midst of all of that? Well, today, this is the story of Joseph. This is how the birth of Jesus took place. The Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. We don't know if Mary told Joseph when she told him she was pregnant, or if he found out some other way that this was from God. We know that Joseph was a righteous man, someone who was directly in line with God, and yet did not want to expose her with public disgrace, so he quietly decided he would dismiss it through divorce. Now, why would he even consider that? Because that child wasn't his. Why would he even consider that? Because he was a righteous man, and he lived according to God's, and for anybody to marry who was pregnant meant that there was a situation there that was not supposed to be. Now, he had many ways he could have done it. He could have exposed her publicly, and she would have been stoned to death. There were many ways he could have done it, so he made what he thought was the most logical, I would say, religiously aligned, righteous decision. He decided to love her and discreetly divorce her. But he was unsettled about that. You see, I really think in his heart that he loved God and he loved Mary, and he was caught in between a rock and a hard place. Do you ever get there? You want to do what God wants you to do, and yet at the same time, you've got this other thing going that's tugging at your heart. And it's hard. It's a hard discussion and trying to make the decision that would be best. And so when he goes to sleep that night, he's figured out what he needs to do, but he's still a little unsettled. And I think he doesn't have the peace of God because he knows there's something else in the equation that he's missing. Do you ever miss it? And so God, realizing that Joseph couldn't put one and one together and make two, or should I say one and one together and make three, comes to him through a dream. He comes to him through a dream, and the dream is one that informs him that what Mary has is of God. Wait a minute. Life created by God. What she has is of God. The angel's visitation presents to him and helps him to understand what this is all about and what he needs to do. What he needs to do in this thing. He begins to talk to him about something that he is even called to do. And this is what we miss sometimes. Because when the angel of the Lord comes to him, he says, Joseph, son of David. Oh, wait a minute. You mean I'm in the mix of this story? Yeah. Joseph, son of David. Now maybe he didn't remember what the scripture said, but my memory is in Isaiah, it says something about this Messiah is going to be from the line of David. But isn't it interesting that he addresses him that way? I mean, God doesn't come up to me and say, Trisha, daughter of Anne. or Michael, son of Harold. God doesn't talk that way, except in this instance. And that's something we often overlook. How many of you have ever overlooked that? It was God's way of saying to Joseph, hey, you know, there's more to you than just being a man, and a righteous man at that. You see, because you are in the line of David, you have been called for a purpose. And guess what? This is where your story is going to intersect with my story. I'm sure that alerted Joseph to the fact that God was doing something there that he had forgotten. He had forgotten he was a part of God's story. He was just living it out as best he could. And yet God was even in the details of every part of his story. It is in that place that God not only reminds him of the right relationship that he has with God, but he also comes to give them the fullness of where the scripture applies to him. Sometimes we read the scripture and we don't connect the dots, but in this, God connected the dots for him. And the angel said, Mary will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Emmanuel. Once again, reminding him of the prophecy, once again, reminding him that God was present with him already. We miss it. Now, here's where the real miracle of the story happens. When Joseph woke up, he did everything the angel of the Lord commanded him to do. And he took Mary home as his wife. And the text we didn't read that needs to be added, I think, is, but he did not know her. He did not have sexual relations with her until she brought forth her firstborn son, and Joseph named him Jesus. Joseph, truly righteous, fully aligned, abiding, obedient man of God, did not waver. It said, when he woke up, he took Mary to be his wife. It was immediate. He didn't wait 6 months. He didn't wait till he figured it out. He didn't wait till he could understand what God was doing. He didn't know all the pieces and parts. He just did what God called him to do. And I think it's in this story that we begin to see what it means to be a truly righteous, loving person. I think the first thing we see is how Joseph balances his relationship of righteousness with God with his love for God and his love for God's people. It is in this place that I believe God gives the greatest testimony through Joseph. You see, we struggle with that. We struggle with that. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man. He didn't want to expose her to public disgrace. He didn't want to throw her under the bus. He wanted to do what Jesus would do. Now, we know of a scripture where the Pharisees and Sadducees pulled the woman of adultery out into the streets. And what does Jesus say? You who is without sin, cast the first stone. Joseph wanted to be like Jesus. He didn't know Jesus, but he knew what it meant to be righteous. And he wanted to be loving and yet holy at the same time. It's in this place that he decided to divorce her quietly until God revealed what God was doing. And it is immediately that he says, oh, thank you for the peace. I now know I'm a part of your story. I think this is an important side of Joseph that we need to share, because I think it's one of the hardest things that we have to do. We're either over here in the righteousness and we end up being judgmental and condemnational, or we're over here loving people and disconnected with God's word. So how can we balance love for God's people and his righteous word at the same time. Take a note from Joseph. Joseph listened to what God told him to do. The world would have said, condemn her. Those who are in that righteous segment would have said, she's an adulterer. Stone her. The people that love everybody say, oh, but it's a baby. What can you do to put those two extremes together? How can you love someone who is a sinner, who dwells in sin, but at the same time be righteous? Wow. That's hard, isn't it? I think it's hard for us. I think it's hard for our church. I think it's hard for the Methodist Church right now. How do we love in the midst of things that are not lovable? In 2 Timothy, it says, retain the standard of the sound words that you've heard from me. It's talking about the word of God. If we ignore the standard of God that he has given to us, his word, then we cease to be the genuine disciple and the genuine church of the Lord Jesus Christ. If we cave into the ways of the world, we become those who follow the world and not the word. But at the same time, if we become insensitive to the sinners in the world, we have one finger pointing at them and three fingers pointing back at ourselves. It's hard being a disciple. We need to follow the example of Joseph and Jesus. We need to be sensitive and loving, even in the midst of understanding we have to be true to God's word. Do you lean on one side or the other? Do you lean on the side towards godly standards and find yourself criticizing others in the world? Watch out. Judge and be ye not judged. Do you find yourself leaning more towards caring for people and compromising your faith and your belief and your righteousness in God? Watch out. It's a slippery slope, and before you know it, you'll be folding into the ways of the world. It's a hard line. Joseph kept himself plumb with God. We also learn that second thing was that he was obedient. In this text, we see that Joseph was obedient to three things, and they're important. The first is he took Mary immediately to be his wife, as the angel of the Lord said. The second is he names Mary's son Jesus, giving up his rights to name his firstborn after himself, which was normal. And three, he had no union with her until after Jesus was born. These all show why God was able to use him as a part of his story. Joseph obeyed the revelation that God gave him. He had no idea what the future was going to be. He had no idea what it was going to cost him. It could have cost him his life. And yet, in obedience, God took him to places where he was able to be the righteous man that he was and abide with God at the same time. He didn't understand about the virgin birth. He didn't understand about the details that were to come. He didn't know he was going to have to take a flight into Egypt, go back to Nazareth. He was going to have to protect all the things that he was going to have to do. He just took one step at a time in obedience to God. And he did it immediately. And that's where we struggle. We struggle because we want to know all the details before we take the first step. Can I have an amen? God says, I want you to take one step to the right, Tricia. Why do you want me to step over there, God? Get it? And so it's in that place that we need to realize that we need to obey. We need to not come to church just to listen to the word, but we need to obey the word that God gives us. Immediately. Immediately. God says in his word, if you love me, you will obey my commandments. He doesn't say you will put them on the shelf and then in 5 days decide to do them. Today is the day. Faithlessness tomorrow, faithfulness tomorrow is a fail of today. today. Remember, delayed obedience is disobedience. That's the first thing. The second thing he acts in obedience is he calls Mary's son Jesus. Now, you think, oh, well, that's just, he just didn't, well, whatever. It doesn't matter. No, it matters. It's a detail that matters in the text. It's significant because not only did he give up his right to name him his own name, which is what every father did so they would follow in business, he gave up his right to claim him as his firstborn son by not naming him Joseph. In that naming of the child Jesus, it not only aligned him with God as Messiah, but it also became, as he named him, he became the legal father, not the one who had actually sowed the seed, but the legal father of the child according to the Semitic law, which meant that he legally adopted Jesus. Okay. Now I want you to think about that just a minute, and I want you to back up at the beginning of the sermon where it said, the angel called him Joseph, son of. So what did that do? By naming him in Jesus, it claimed him as the legal heir of Joseph, but at the same time, it brought him into the line of David. Legally, and in the line of David. There's all this argument, well, was Mary of the line of David? Was Joseph of the line of David? Well, right here we see it doesn't matter. Because basically Jesus was begotten of the Holy Spirit, but he was legally the son of Joseph and heir and the promises of the line of David. Finally, and the one that sometimes we also overlook is Joseph had no union with Mary until after Jesus was born. Yeah. What does that matter? I want you to think a minute for me. In this, Joseph does several things. Not only does he protect God's story so there won't be any scandal, he also kept Mary holy as a holy vessel because she was supposed to have a virgin birth. Oh. And then in addition to this, Joseph upholds his responsibility as Jesus' earthly father so that there will be no doubt in the testimony. Now, would you and I have figured that out? Absolutely not. He'd already waited probably a year and a half to 2 years to even be wed with her, and I imagine that his hormones were in a place where he didn't want to wait. But he did because of God. Aubrey and Jared didn't wait. Many people today don't wait. Once again, we see how it's supposed to be according to God. And so he waited until that day when he was allowed by God to call Mary his own. Waited. And it was in that waiting that he is allowed to protect the child. He's allowed to protect God's story. He is allowed to bring and guard Mary and that child forward. And then the flight to Egypt, the flight back to Nazareth, and protecting that child and bringing him up in a trade of carpentry. He was a righteous man who was faithful and loving and obedient to God. That's why we hear about him every Christmas. That's why we get to see his story is really God's story. And if you think about it, it's our story too, isn't it? Because Emmanuel, God, has become with us and one of us. And he shares his story with us. What happens when we step out? When we hear what God has to say, when we follow God in faith, his story becomes our story. His love becomes our love. His word becomes a part of who we are. That is the call of God today. It's our calling. It's the Christmas calling. That his story would be our story and our story would be in his story. That's what makes the difference in the world. That's what made the difference in Joseph. And as we come to the table today, it is that incarnational presence in the communion that changes us, that begins a new story in our life, that begins to infuse Jesus into us. And he calls that story forward from this day forward. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for this holy story in which you have spoken through Joseph. And we ask that that same story would speak in and through us. As we gather around table today, forgive us where we have misstepped. And open our hearts that we might receive the fullness of your story in our lives. And we pray this all through Jesus. And all the people say, amen. As we come to the word and table, we invite you to confess your sins with me as I invite you to come to this holy banquet that God has prepared for us. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace, shalom, wholeness with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray, and free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Beloved, hear this good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like the ever-flowing stream, when nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all your company of heaven, we join their unending hymn, saying together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Yes, holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the light to nations. You scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from thrones and exalted those of low degree. You filled the hungry with good things and the rich you sent away empty. Your own Son came among us as a servant, to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death and made with us a new covenant by the water and the Spirit. On the night in which the Lord Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, This is my body given for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of all sin. Take and drink. Do this in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in thanksgiving and praise as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as our lives proclaim that mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, O God, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we might be the body of Christ, redeemed by his precious blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in that final victory and we feast together at his heavenly banquet. We pray this through your Son, Jesus Christ, your Holy Spirit, and your Holy Church. For all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore, and all the people say amen. And now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer that the Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. The table is set and the Lord invites you to come. You do not need to be a member of this church. You do not need to be anyone except for someone who loves Jesus and wants to know that converting, that wonderful gift of his presence in your life. If there is someone, Faye and Jeff, do you need? You do. Okay. So for Faye and Jeff, I need somebody. If you take one back to them, is there anybody else who needs Vernon to bring you one? Right here in the middle. Anybody on this side? Miss Harriet, do you need one or do you want to come down? You're coming down, okay. I invite you to come as the Holy Spirit leads. Come and partake of the blessing of Christ. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The body and go forth and multiply that presence and share in the bounty of his grace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. Thank you. take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ poured out for you for the forgiveness of all sins. Take and drink. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we give you thanks for the holy mystery and the way that you reveal yourself through our lives, through the lives of Jesus, through the testimonies in your word. Help our life to be a testimony of your faithfulness and our faithfulness to you. We pray this as we go forth this day in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bow down before him, love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus our Lord. I want to let you know that there are several of our beloved that are challenged today. Will Rollins is struggling. Please drop him a card, give him a call. Make sure you call before you go visit. Nancy has her hands full. Also, Joanne, Curtis Rook is not here today because Joanne is in the hospital and has been in the hospital for a couple of days. Maxine Rollins is also struggling. They have called in hospice. Please make sure that you keep them in your prayers. And if there's others, I'd like to take this moment for us just to lift up their names in the name of Jesus. Father, hear this, the prayers of your people, as we lift those who you have called us to be in ministry with and to and through. Allow our stories to intersect with their stories. Tell us what to do, Lord, as we lift them to your throne. Hear this, the prayers of your people. Lord, for these prayers on our hearts and in our lives and the holy privilege of being able to pray, we give you thanks. Now, Lord, we ask that you would be present with those who we have lifted up in name and who are still on our lips. Show us what we need to do that our story will intersect with their story and that our lives will be the story of God. We pray this all through the name of Jesus, and all the people say, amen. Our closing hymn this morning is Great is Thy Faithfulness. Oh, dearly beloved, what a story we have heard today. A story of faith, a story of hope, a story of love and mercy. Go forth and be that same story. Go forth and allow God to write his story on your hearts and in your lives. Go forth in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.